coming.
Television for and about children has long been the source of controversy among parents, educators, and oftentimes children themselves. That children take their television favorites as their role models has long been known, and that's why it's such a pleasure for us to have one of the best role models of television with us here this evening. If little girls all over the world grow up like this, then we don't have to worry about our next generation. Ladies and gentlemen, the co-star of Mork and Mindy, Pam Dauber.
Not too long ago, children's television could have been summed up as exploitive, non-essential, and that old junk food for the mind. But in the past few years, young people have become older, much younger, and the problems which once were those of adults now face teenagers regularly. It wasn't easy for television to face the problems of teenage pregnancy, alcoholism, drug abuse, disease, and others. But this year particularly, it seems to have taken some significant first steps.
Chad, when did you first find out that you had an illness?
Barely a year ago, not really a year ago.
What happened? What did they say?
That I had cancer, told me and my mom, in this, like, little conference room.
Did you know what cancer meant?
Yeah, I had a very good idea what it meant. It meant it was an illness that could kill you. That's about all I knew about cancer.
But it looks like you're a pretty tough guy and it didn't even faze you.
it fazed me.
We get the fear sometimes, but we just have to go on with life and, you know, forget about that, do the best that you can, and keep living. You know, they said I was only going to live 2 years, and here I am on TV.
The markings between what is a show for children and what is a show for adults have become harder to distinguish, which may be good for all of us. Witness these examples of last year's children's programs whose obvious intent is to explore some of the problems that face people young and old alike.
Well, you're at it again, troublemaker. Troublemakers. You're no good. Either one of you, just like your father. Get yourselves in trouble and you expect me to come and get you out. Don't you?
I'm sorry, Mom.
I don't want to hear how sorry you are. I'm tired of hearing how sorry you are. That's not going to pay for the day's work I'm going to lose because of you. We're almost broke now, and it's all your fault because you're bad. You are a bad...
Stop it, Ma!
What are you doing? Let go of me!
I'm not going to let you hurt Brian anymore.
You what?
Look, I've had it with this. Nancy's right about you. You're sick.
Nancy? What does she have to do with this?
Get your coat on.
Where are you going?
I'm taking him out of here. You're not going to hit him anymore because we won't be here.
Michael! Michael, you get back here!
Television this year also dealt with adolescent sex in several shows and with several approaches, among them drama and factual presentation.
Well, you know, when your clock starts going and you have your period and you can have a baby, you become physically ready to have a baby. That doesn't necessarily mean that you're ready in other ways to have a baby, right?
Right.
How do you think you know when the rest of you is ready?
When you're married.
Right, when you're married.
Good idea.
Yeah.
When you're old enough to handle responsibility.
Uh-huh.
Like now, you know, if I get pregnant, I can go out and find a job, you know, and raise, you know, a child.
Yeah.
I'm only 13.
For younger viewers, CBS has created a very interesting concept called the CBS Library, in which books are dramatized but left unfinished for the viewers to read the endings themselves. And ABC has integrated the commercial format, perhaps the one best known by kids, into a series of commercials for health and nutrition. And it continues its Schoolhouse Rock series of three-minute lessons about history and English and all sorts of other subjects. And NBC, through its Project Peacock series, has moved children's programming into prime time with a series of innovative programs that promises to continue. And this report would not be complete without the mention of PBS programming like Sesame Street, The Electric Company, and so much more that has set the standard for children's educational television over a decade ago. The boundaries that once limited television's ability to cross the generation gap now seem to be the very thing that provides a connection between young and old. And if families watch some of these programs together, maybe what will follow will be a greater understanding for everybody. Last year, the editors of TV Guide magazine established an annual award, the TV Guide Life Achievement Award, to be presented to an individual who has made an outstanding contribution to the quality of television during his or her career. The late Edward R. Murrow was its first recipient. This year, the top editors of the magazine met to consider those persons who best exemplify those standards, and we are pleased to have with us an old friend of this year's award winner, who will make the second presentation of the TV Guide Life Achievement Award. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Bob Hope.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Television is noted for the speed in which it uses up ideas, talent, and programming product. Unlike the movies, dance, theater, and opera, television is often criticized for not being a true art form. In the past 30 years, one man, more than any other, not only brought the finest of other great art forms to the home screen, but created entertainment concepts unique to television that continue to this day. That man is Sylvester L. Pat Weaver, Jr. Following a 17-year career in broadcasting and advertising, Pat Weaver came to NBC as vice president for programming in 1949. Among his earliest successes were the live comedy show, best exemplified by the unique achievements of Sid Caesar and Imogene Coca on your Show of Shows.
Yes, sir. This is your story, Al Duntze. Seems to be a little overwhelmed by Al. He's a little Al. Al Duntze. Come on up here, Al.
And by using rotating hosts such as Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis on the Colgate Comedy Hour.
You see what you just did?
I didn't do nothing.
Shut up, I'll give you a squint. Look, listen to me.
I just stood there. I didn't say a word.
It's all on the comedy. I like it. I like it. They don't squeeze it. Don't push it. What do you thought? What? It's all you. They didn't do anything about me.
Oh, in other words, that everything they said was me. Don't shake it.
It's
I like
you.
It. Oh, it's all me.
Sure.
All right. I don't want to be in trouble with you. Then I'll start singing.
No, I like it. I like it that way. I like it. Don't sing it.
Don't sing it. All right, I'll introduce your song. Ladies and gentlemen.
It was Pat Weaver's creative genius that led him to introduce the first magazine format program on television in 1952. The Today Show with its first host, Dave Garraway.
This is the busiest communication center in the world. It takes 154 of us working every morning from 5 o'clock to 10 a.m. to gather and to translate and examine and edit today's world into a form of television program which, believe me, is new. It's called Today.
More Weaver-created magazine shows soon followed. The Tonight Show in 1953 and Home in 1954. Continuing to experiment with the natural forms of the infant medium, he introduced the concept of the spectacular, a one-time-only event that preempted regular programs. It was presented live and is now commonly known as the special. He gave us great theaters such as Peter Pan with Mary Martin.
But you could get well again if children believed in fairies. Do you believe? Oh, please, please believe. If you believe, wherever you are, clap your hands and she'll hear you.